former Hour of Power host Robert Schuller weighs in on the Crystal Cathedral bankruptcy. Plus,
this name was every pastor's nightmare.
A pastor is stalked and then shot.
He said, "You're going to have to run for help." And I'm running as fast as my little 7-year-old legs can take me.
The devil in pew number 7.
I didn't know if he was going to come out and shoot the rest of us.
On today's 700 Club.
Well, welcome to the 700 Club. Once again, American leaders find themselves preparing for the possibility of a terrorist attack. This time, they believe al-Qaeda wants to take revenge for the killing of Osama bin Laden.
Extra security measures are being put in place both in America and overseas. Ephraim Graham has the story.
The anniversary of Osama bin Laden's death is quickly approaching. Intelligence chatter is up, and U.S. officials are concerned.
I think it's a major issue for al-Qaeda to do something to prove they're still alive, to do some fairly major event or series of attacks that prove that they're not down, they're not out.
President Obama has been briefed about possible al-Qaeda plans for retaliation for bin Laden's killing. Officials say they don't have specific information about an imminent strike, but al-Qaeda's top bomb maker, Ibrahim Hassan al-Asiri, has just resurfaced in Yemen. Al-Asiri is believed to be responsible for the so-called underwear bomb, as well as the bombs hidden in printers that al-Qaeda tried to ship to Chicago. U.S. intelligence says he could be building more bombs to use against the U.S.
It doesn't take a great number of people to do the kind of attack that we had on September 11th. That was less than 24 people. And it's clear that they have that number available in places like Yemen today.
Meanwhile, the White House is stepping up the fight against al-Qaeda in Yemen, giving the go-ahead for expanded drone attacks against targets there. Officials now say individuals who are planning attacks against the U.S. will be targeted, even if they can't be identified by name. That's a change in U.S. policy. The attacks will be carried out only with Yemeni government approval. All this comes as one State Department official tells the National Journal, quote, "The war on terror is over." The source said the Obama administration believes radical Muslims may see the Arab Spring as a new outlet for their Islamism. Ephraim Graham, CBN News.
Well, certainly we live in very uncertain times. Be in prayer for our president. Be in prayer for the leaders of Congress, for those in charge of our intelligence services, that they would have unusual wisdom. I think in this day and age, we need wisdom that is beyond human capacity. We need wisdom from on high. George Thomas has the rest of our top stories from the CBN newsroom. George?
Thank you, Gordon. Hello, everyone. Well, the Labor Department has withdrawn a proposed rule for child labor on farms. The rule would have cut back on the work kids would be allowed to do on farms. But the plan came under heavy fire from supporters of farming in Congress and the private sector. The 85-page proposal would have forbidden kids under 16 from working with most power-driven machinery, grain storage, many types of livestock work, and more. Some call it absurd, and other an overreach by federal government that's gotten too big. The White House says it's committed to listening to what Americans have to say about proposed rules and regulations. The U.S. Air Force will no longer require that Bibles be put on a checklist of items in lodging facilities on bases. The Military Association of Atheists and Freethinkers complained about the Bibles. Bibles are placed in the Air Force rooms by the Gideons at no cost to the government. The Blaze reports after a legal review, Air Force officials ruled there is no requirement to have Bibles in the lodging checklist. Bible supporters say Air Force officials are bowing to political pressure to create a religion-free zone in the Air Force. The economic crisis in Spain is getting worse. Unemployment has reached 24% today. Spain is now in a recession. It's the fourth largest economy in the eurozone and the 12th largest in the world. Standard & Poor's downgraded Spain's credit rating Thursday. The country is facing the possibility of even more downgrades in the future. even though its credit rating is already just three steps above junk. That could mean Spain would need more bailout loans. Coming up on the 700 Club, we'll have a look at how the economic crisis in Europe has hurt the continent's young people. Well, America's youngest generation seem to be experts when it comes to the latest technology, from cell phone apps and Facebook to iPads and iPhones. And as you can imagine, parents are finding it hard to keep up. As Charlene Israel reports, the technology gap could be placing many children at risk.
Tiffany Shortridge considers herself pretty technologically savvy. The 28-year-old mom uses technology on a regular basis, but she says even that isn't always enough when it comes to keeping up with her 9-year-old son, Anthony.
I use the internet and the computer pretty often because I go to school, but there are certain things that I don't even know exist that I'll hear him talk about, and I'll have to ask him what it is that he's talking about.
Tiffany is not alone in this. In a recent study, internet security company AVG found that almost half of today's children ages 6 through 9 use the internet. Yet 58% of their parents admit that they are not familiar with the sites their children use.
More kids can access the internet today than can ride a bike. You know, it's just, there's statistics that just really point to the fact that young children growing up, all they know is access to the internet. You know, they can touch screens on an iPad or like device. You know, it's very easy for them to navigate.
But while children may be quick to pick up on the latest technological skills, many are too young to be aware of the threats that come along with it.
I think parents do need to be concerned about their children's online safety. Kids are growing up more in kind of a social arena where information is more public. You know, they don't necessarily know better.
Experts say the important thing is not to keep children from technology, but to make sure they aren't trying to navigate their way through it alone. For Tiffany and Anthony, it's about trust and some good old-fashioned rules.
There has to be a lot of trust between he and I, that he knows what he's allowed to do on the internet and that I believe that he's going to do it and that he's going to be honest with me about what he's dealing with. I don't let him have alone time, like in his bedroom with the computer. If he's ever going to like search anything, like Google anything, he has to ask us.
Director of Plugged In Online, Bob Walaszewski, says that a little tough love can help keep your children safe.
Parents have to be in that world. They have to know where their kids are. And I think it's okay to snoop a little, too.
Tiffany says she appreciates how far technology has come and the opportunities that her children will have because of it. But she's also prepared to do what it takes to protect them from it.
I think that the days of like some people being into technology and some people not are kind of over. So just necessity requires that I keep up.
You can't not access the internet. It's really part of the fabric of their childhood. So let's just make sure that that's safe.
Charlene Israel, CBN News.
Gordon, I know you are very technologically savvy, but you've also got two young kids. Do you snoop on them?
Shh. all the various browsers have plenty of ways where you can track the history and look things up. And, you know, they so far haven't figured out how to get around those. Terry, what do you do with yours?
Pray. Lots and lots of prayer.
I'm falling behind.
Yeah.
That
and
there
you're
are a lot
way
of
more technologically
there,
savvy than
there
I
are
am.
A lot of new things coming, and just the, you know, how much time do I have to put in to discover what's the new
and
stuff?
And social networks make it a very pressured thing for young people to be engaged in all of that, and information available and open.
Well, for them,
things.
It's the hot new thing, mm-hmm. and so the buzz goes out instantly. Try those, look at those, and that kind of thing. So.
Yeah, it's. I think it's incredibly difficult to be raising children right now, and I don't have a fast and sure answer. I think what she said. You know, monitor it, watch them, but most of all, communicate with them what the peril is. I mean, you got to talk about
big
it.
Big issue is communication, and mm-hmm. then in that communication, communicate that you trust them. If you do that, I think that, and add, as Terry does, a good dose of prayer.
Well, up next, more than 50% of young people under the age of 25 are unemployed. Find out who they are, where they live, and why they're so angry after this. And then later on, he's out to inspire 1 million acts of forgiveness. Gospel singer Kevin LaVar performs his hit song, A Heart That Forgives, and that's on today's 700 Club.
Just like yours above, one that overcomes evil with goodness and love. Like it never happened, never holding a grudge. Want a heart that...
Have you ever heard the expression, good as gold? Well, gold is on everybody's minds these days, and rightfully so, having risen in value dramatically since 2001. For years now, I've been singing the praises of one of the most recognized and trusted names in gold, Swiss America. They believe, like I do, that people need to know what's good about gold. Gold has withstood the test of time, and so has Swiss America. Now's the time to rediscover gold, because gold offers diversification, profit potential, and best of all, privacy. Call or visit online now and ask for the Pat Boone DVD, and they'll gladly rush out a copy along with other information about getting gold into your nest egg. If you're going to buy gold, buy it from a company you can trust. I did. And I've been a satisfied Swiss America customer for over 15 years. They are as good as gold. Call or log on right now.
Monday.
I've got bubbles, air is escaping from someplace.
A scuba accident takes one diver from the bottom of the lake.
I started really feeling like I'm in trouble.
To the brink of eternity.
It was a place that I knew I was welcome.
We kick off our week of prayer.
I remember actually having to specifically make the decision. Do I stay or do I come back?
Monday on the 700 Club.
Despite economic problems here in the United States, it's much worse in Europe. And young people are among those hit hardest. Dale Hurd brings us the story of Europe's lost generation.
Near Lisbon, Portugal, a locksmith is cutting the bolts off an apartment that has been repossessed by the court. And he's putting new locks on the door. The family isn't home, and the place looks like they abandoned it. The locksmith, David Justino, says, if it was just evicting adults, it wouldn't be a problem for me. We're all adults, and we have to deal with it. What's hard is when there are children or disabled people. What some call a recession is in countries like Portugal, Greece, and Spain, a full-blown depression that's hitting young people and the elderly the hardest. In Spain, the unemployment rate is 23.6%. Close to the highest levels in the United States during the Great Depression. But the unemployment rate for Spaniards under the age of 25 is an incredible 50.4%, the highest in Western Europe, higher than Greece. It's created a lost generation of 20-somethings with very bleak prospects ahead of them. The adoption of the euro currency was supposed to take Spain in a prosperous direction.
Spain is one of the EU countries being crushed by the euro. The one-size-fits-all nature of the currency is actually fighting against Spain's efforts to recover.
On the outskirts of Barcelona, you can see one of the cemeteries for Spain's shattered real estate bubble. Buildings once under construction, now abandoned. Gravestones for a boom time that vanished. Now Barcelona blogger Santiago Perez runs a website called The New Poor, where Spain's lost generation can share their struggles. His friend Eric Luent has already decided to leave Spain for Iceland.
We have no prospects. It is very difficult to plan your life here, so we are now thinking of moving abroad. It is strange how the economic crisis has changed our viewpoint so quickly and so radically.
Judith Sanz is an out-of-work agricultural engineer.
I've been unemployed for 13 months now. Nowadays, things look so bad that I am contemplating the possibility of moving abroad. The way things look today, I'm seriously thinking about it.
Alberto Rodriguez says when he finishes his MBA, he wants to move to London. During the good economic times, Europeans assumed their lavish welfare state worked well. But a historic debt crisis, business failures, and high unemployment levels have created societies in which young people just starting out see no future. No way to start their careers. Many Western nations have made it hard, if not impossible, to be an entrepreneur. In Paris, Clément Grandjean found it so hard to start a business as a young entrepreneur that instead he started a Dilbert-style comic strip that makes fun of the business culture and government regulations in France.
All the ships look the same, so it represents the path that everybody will tend to follow if they were following what society wanted them to go.
While still working on his MBA, Ranjan was trying to set up a company to export French products to Japan. Then the French government started demanding money.
And I received a really, really expensive tax that I had to pay, even if I didn't make any profit, so we worked really hard. And then government were asking us like $2,000 each just for having creating the business, even if we earned $0. So we decided to stop the business before it became too expensive.
Ranjan considered leaving France, but decided to stay and try to navigate the business culture. But polls have shown most French young people wouldn't even think of starting a business. They want lifetime government jobs. Across Europe, the lost generation is angry because it believes it was handed a mess it didn't create. Too many also live with their parents, sometimes into their 40s, like Nuno Pinto in Portugal, who's already thrown in the towel and filed for bankruptcy.
I am 40 years old, and I'm living off my parents. That's my painful reality. For that reason, I'm here, to see if I can get, what's my last chance, a personal bankruptcy.
When these are the prospects that young people have to look forward to, it shows just how bad it's become for Europe's lost generation. Dale Hurd, CBN News, in Barcelona.
Well, this is what happens when the government becomes one of the biggest employers and you get into entitlement payments. And then how do you pay for that? Well, you pay for that through taxes. And there comes a tipping point. Are we going to face that in America? I think so. Bank of America came out with a report about a year ago that's saying if you got rid of all discretionary spending at the federal government, just completely eliminated it, so every single department got shut down, every single one, you still wouldn't solve the deficit. Now, here's something chilling. If you add to that all military spending, which isn't considered discretionary spending, you still haven't solved the deficit. Only when we come to grips with the entitlement payments from Social Security and Medicare, I'm not talking about cutting the benefit, but when we start thinking in terms of 51% of the population of America receives some kind of fund from the U.S. government, well, then how is that sustainable? How do you make that work? Back in ancient Greece, as soon as a democracy figured out how to vote itself, the city treasury, that was the first step leading to the destruction of the democracy, and in comes tyranny. Tyranny is an old Greek word, and it's when a despot takes control in a time of economic emergency to save the city. Are we going to face that in America? I don't know. But what I do know is on either side of the aisle, Republican or Democrat, no one's bringing up the issue, and it's a big issue that we all have to face. Terry?
Well, coming up, a pastor and his family are stalked and terrorized.
He worked his way up from harassing phone calls and threatening letters to the drive-by shootings, and then he began with the dynamite explosions. And we had 10 explosions in 2.5 years around our church and our home.
And that was not the worst of what he did. Meet the man dubbed the devil in pew number 7 when we come back.
If you have diabetes and you're on Medicare, call now for a new pain-free meter. These new meters are more accurate, they're easier to use, and the best news is you don't have to prick your fingers anymore. Call now, and Arriva Medical will send you one of these new meters for free. And if you have Medicare, your testing supplies may also be covered. Arriva makes it simple. They bill Medicare directly. There are no upfront costs, and they deliver your supplies right to your door for free. With these new meters, there's no coding, you don't have to prick your fingers, and some of these meters even talk.
Your blood glucose reading is 122.
withdrawal. 1-800-284-4105. We will send you a free Betty Crocker Diabetes Cookbook filled with delicious recipes.
Call Arriva today. You'd be glad you did.
Hi, I'm Dr. Joyce Brothers. Those of us who are independent and live alone shouldn't do so without having emergency protection. And for reliability and peace of mind, I recommend the Alert USA Emergency Response System.
With Alert USA, simply wear our pendant in and around your home. And if you ever fall or otherwise need assistance, just press the button to be connected to a specially trained operator who can summon help anytime, day or night.
I believe that in these tough times, Alert USA provides the best emergency support and value for your dollar.
Right now, for a limited time, get the Alert USA system for just 50 cents a day. You'll also get our free 911 emergency cell phone that'll protect you when you're away from home or in a blackout. A phone so advanced, it can even take your blood pressure. Plus, we'll include a free smoke detector with 24-hour monitoring. Only Alert USA protects you and your home no matter where you are.
For a free Alert USA brochure, call now at 1-800-839-9639. That's 1-800-839-9639.
You're about to see an extraordinary story of forgiveness. In 1969, Rebecca Nichols and her family lived next door to the church where her dad was pastor. Across the street lived a man who was obsessed with controlling the church. He terrorized the family, trying to drive them out of town. Then one night, when she was just 7 years old, Rebecca saw the unthinkable happen right before her very eyes.
Nobody takes my wife! No! Nobody out!
He said, "You're gonna have to run for help." And I'm running with everything I've got in me, as fast as my little seven-year-old legs can take me.
With her mother lying dead in the next room,
Rebecca!
And her father seriously wounded from a gunshot, Rebecca ran to a neighbor's house for help.
I was so scared because I didn't know what this guy was going to do. I didn't know if he was going to come out and shoot the rest of us.
The events of that night were actually the culmination of years of torment at the hands of one man, an elderly neighbor whose jealousy eventually turned deadly. Rebecca wrote about it in her book, The Devil in Pew Number 7. Mr. Horry Watts was well off and well connected. He was used to calling the shots. That is until Rebecca's father, Robert Nichols, a young, handsome preacher, took over at the Free Welcome Holiness Church in Sellerstown, North Carolina. The congregation loved him and his wife, Ramona, and the church flourished. But Mr. Watts, who always sat in pew number 7, did everything he could to drive the Nichols out of town.
This man was every pastor's nightmare. He would point at his watch if he thought my dad had been preaching too long. He would get up and walk out and slam the door, so they had the doors replaced so that he couldn't slam them anymore, which made him even madder.
But this was only the beginning.
He worked his way up from harassing phone calls and threatening letters to the drive-by shootings, and then when he realized all of those things weren't going to work, then he began with the dynamite explosions. Mm. And we had 10 explosions in 2.5 years around our church and our home.
One of the explosions shook the house so hard, her baby brother's life was put in danger.
That explosion blew out 2 or 3 windows in that room where my brother was sleeping. He was just a little baby. And my mom would read Psalms 91 to me about how God would cover you with his feathers, that his angels would watch over us. And my brother did not have one piece of glass on him.
Although the Nichols knew who was terrorizing them, they couldn't prove it, and the police moved painstakingly slow on the case. But instead of taking matters into their own hands, Rebecca watched her parents pray for Mr. Watts, praying for this hard-hearted man to come to Jesus.
What did that teach you about forgiveness?
Well, I heard my dad preach about it in the pulpit on Sunday and Sunday night and Wednesday. We were in church 3 times a week. And then I prayed with my mother about that same forgiveness. So I heard it in church, and then we lived it at home. So their example to me was just amazing, how they weren't just preaching it, they were living it.
Although there would be breaks from the harassment, even months of relative calm, fear of the next explosion tormented young Rebecca.
How did you sleep at night?
I had a hard time sleeping at night. I would always try to crawl into my parents' bed. So at night, as a little girl, you could look out my window and see him pacing back and forth in front of our home.
Plotting his next move.
And so he stalked our family.
After every effort to run the Nichols out of town failed, the unthinkable happened. Mr. Watts knew that the Nichols were taking care of a woman who was seeking shelter from her abusive husband. He talked the husband, William Harris, into taking care of the Nichols.
My dad, when he was shot, fell to the floor because one of the bullets went into his hip and he was unable to move. This big guy, you know, my hero, our protector, was, you know, just slammed to the floor with that bullet.
Although Rebecca's father survived the shooting, her mother didn't make it. Rebecca says the years of torment and anxiety and the loss of his beloved wife took a severe toll on her father, not just physically, but mentally as well.
He and my mom were best friends. They were soulmates. They had done so much ministering together. They were partners in life. And when he lost her, a big part of him died as well.
Mr. Nichols died a few short years later from a blood clot when he was only 46. Rebecca struggled to forgive not only the men who tormented her family and robbed her of a normal childhood, she also struggled to forgive God.
I got pretty mad at God, and I said, Lord, when mother was killed, a man took her life. But when daddy died, you took him. And so after 2 years of wrestling with God over that, I realized that I needed God more than I needed to be mad at him.
Both men eventually served some jail time for their crimes. Mr. Harris served the most, 21 years. And then, out of the blue, when Rebecca was 17, she received a surprise phone call from Mr. Watts.
He said, I want to know, I can't live the rest of my life without knowing if you've forgiven me or not. And I said, Mr. Watts, my brother and I forgave you a long time ago. And he just sat there and kind of wept. He said, I'm out of prison. But during that 1 year, he found a relationship with God. Not when he was in church services every week with us, but when he was in prison alone with himself and his sin.
Right.
That's when he found Jesus.
Amazing.
And he said, I want you to know that your dad was a good man and that he didn't deserve what I put him through.
Then recently, after 33 years, Rebecca and her brother came face to face with the man who shot their parents and killed their mother. It happened on the Dr. Phil show, and Mr. Harris whispered his apology, something they never thought they would hear. Today, Rebecca is married to a preacher herself and has two beautiful children. She says in writing the book, she had to forgive all over again, but says God is faithful to help you forgive if you let him.
We all need forgiveness. And that's what I tell people when they say, how did you forgive? I said, well, I watched my parents as a little girl, but as I got older, I got the revelation of how Jesus forgave us on the cross. He gave everything so that we could live a life of freedom.
Well, it's so hard, isn't it, to forgive, because usually where forgiveness is involved, something's been done that shouldn't have happened, that was unfair, that cost us something. Why does God ask us to forgive our enemies? Well, I look at Rebecca's life and I see that she has a tremendous message of forgiveness for others. But what I see most of all is, despite all that happened to her, all that happened to her family, all the loss that she suffered, Rebecca is free. Rebecca is living with the joy of the Lord, with the power of the Lord. She's living in victory. How did that happen? It happened because she chose to forgive. Forgiving doesn't mean that you're condoning what was being done. Sometimes you have to forgive out of obedience just because God tells us to. Sometimes you have to do it when you don't feel like it, and then as God works in us because we've been obedient to Him, our hearts catch up with what we've said yes to. You know, it's hard to imagine what it would be like to embrace the killer of your parents, to receive the I'm sorry for something that took such a toll and cost such a price in your life. She gave him freedom in her forgiving and accepting his apology, but she received it too. And so she can live in victory. She can live with the power of God alive in her life. She can live with light in her soul and joy in her step as she raises her own children. Is that easy? Absolutely not. No one ever said it was easy, but she hit the nail on the head when she talked about the fact that Jesus, who had done nothing wrong, who took upon himself the sin of all of us, looked down from the place of his own murder, of his own hanging, of his own excruciating pain, and said, "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they do." And you know, that's so true of many of the people who wound us in our own lives. Sometimes they're people who've been wounded themselves. Where does that stop if we don't draw a line in the sand and say, "God, I'm going to be your child in this situation. I'm going to say yes to your call to me to offer forgiveness to the one who's wounded me." There will come such a freedom for you in that. You will not believe how it will change your life. But the reason Rebecca was able to do that was she knew the one who had hung on the cross for her and who offered forgiveness to her first. You need to know Jesus. You need to understand how much he loves you. And you know what? When you're angry with him about something, he can handle your anger. He's bigger than that. So pray with me now. Just stop what you're doing and pray and say yes. Say yes because you love Jesus and because he's asked you to do it. Your heart will catch up with you. Let's pray. God, I'm watching this story and I'm thinking of my own life and the people who have wounded or hurt me that I need to say, "I forgive you too." Not because they're asking for it, not because they deserve it, but because you've called me to this higher ground of forgiveness and because you've forgiven me. So I say yes today, God. I say yes today, and I'm asking you to do a work in my heart that will catch my heart up to my words and my will so that I can serve you all the days of my life in freedom and in victory. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for loving me, waiting for me, forgiving me, and helping me to let go of the things that have been done that have hurt my life, my heart, my soul. I want all of you today, Jesus. I want you to be Lord of my life, Redeemer of my soul. I want you to be my all in all, and I give you all that I am today. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. Empower me to live for you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you've just prayed that, we want to send you a packet called A New Day. What do you do now that you've committed your life to Christ? This is full of information. And if forgiveness has been an issue in your life, ask for this too. It's a little brochure called Forgiveness, filled with the Word of God. All of this is available to you by calling that toll-free number. It's 1-800-759-0700. Just say, "I prayed that prayer and I'd like the free materials." We'll get them out to you right away. And as we're talking about forgiveness, here to inspire you is gospel recording artist Kevin LaVar singing "A Heart That Forgives."
Thank you.
That was awesome.
Bless you.
What a strong, powerful song. I mean, it just stirs your heart to hear it. People everywhere have reacted so strongly to that. Were you surprised by that?
Yes. I was very surprised by it.
Why do you think that is, Kevin?
Because people are hurting. You can't go through life without getting some kind of hurt. And in the body of Christ, so many of us are hurting. And we're ministering to people, but we're bleeding.
And sometimes we don't understand that forgiveness is the key to unlocking that.
To unlocking everything.
Everything.
Destiny,
God's blessings, too.
Everything.
Yeah.
It's the key, and some of us are like on pause.
Yes.
And we don't realize why we're on pause, but we're on pause because we can't move past the iniquity of unforgiveness in our hearts.
You have a wonderful and amazing campaign to kind of help usher people into the freedom that forgiveness brings. Tell us about that.
Because of the testimonies that came in, because of the song, A Heart That Forgives, we started a campaign called Forgive and Live Today. And it's a campaign to raise 1 million acts of forgiveness.
How does that work?
Basically, people can go to the website and they can fill out a forgiveness. Like, they can send e-cards to people.
Wow.
They can do video. They can upload videos and send in their personal testimonies. They can send in emails. They can type right in who they forgive and send that that forgiveness, the act of forgiveness in. And we're traveling to all 50 states. We had a big launch event, 7,000 people came. We had acting and so many different, we had music, and it was just beautiful. And so many people let go. They decided to forgive and live.
Tell us the site again.
It's forgiveandlivetoday.org.
Forgiveandlivetoday.org. Wow, that is an amazing opportunity to facilitate all of this freedom and victory in your own life and blessing. Want to remind you of that.
Yes.
If you'd like to learn more about Kevin's Forgive and Live campaign, log on to CBN.com if you didn't get that website, because we've got it there for you. And to hear more of Kevin's music, pick up a copy of his CD. It's called Let's Come Together. Fabulous, fabulous, inspiring music available for you wherever music is sold. And right now, we're going to take a little break here, and Kevin's going to play as we go to break. We'll be back with more of the 700 Club after this.
Still ahead.
I just didn't feel it was appropriate to divide the ministry.
The demise of the Crystal Cathedral.
And I was removed from that position to make any decisions about what's going to happen in the future of that ministry.
Robert Shuler joins us live, coming up.
Hi, I'm Terry Musin. At CBN, we're here to pray for you all year long. But each spring, the entire staff of CBN sets aside a special week of prayer to pray for your needs. We care about you and the things that are happening in your life. No matter how big or small your requests, we want to pray for you. Please mail your prayer request today. It's our privilege to pray for you.
John Mapes is 42, mortgage, married, two great kids. He wants to protect his family with a $500,000 term life insurance policy. What do you think it'll cost him? $100 a month? 60? 40? Actually, none of the above. John can get a $500,000 policy from a highly rated insurer for under $25 a month. His secret? SelectQuote. SelectQuote is impartial. They'll search the pick of insurers like these to give you a choice of your best prices. SelectQuote has great savings on term life for women, too. John's wife, Carrie, can get a $500,000 policy for under $16 a month. SelectQuote has helped make term life insurance affordable for hundreds of thousands of people since 1985. How about you? Just call this number or visit SelectQuote.com.
And welcome back to the 700 Club. A memorial service for Chuck Colson will be held next month at the National Cathedral in Washington, D.C. Prison Fellowship Ministries is holding the memorial. Colson died last Saturday at the age of 80. The former aide to President Richard Nixon served time in prison after the Watergate scandal. He then started Prison Fellowship Ministries, reaching people for Christ all across the world. The May 16th service will be open to the public and streamed live on the cathedral's website. Operation Blessing is working to make sure vulnerable children and families are protected from malaria. Every 30 seconds, a child under the age of 5 dies from malaria in sub-Saharan Africa. On Wednesday, World Malaria Day was celebrated to bring awareness to the deadly disease. Operation Blessing teams distributed bed nets to more than 100 families in a small village in Niger. The nets provide a safe barrier between the families and the malaria-carrying mosquitoes. You can find out more about Operation Blessing by going to their website at ob.org. Gordon and Terry will be back with more of the 700 Club right after this.
Are you noticing more wrinkles, frown lines, or sagging skin? This is Eloise at age 69. Eloise didn't like how she looked in the mirror. Wrinkles on her face and sagging skin around her neck were making her look old. So she decided to look younger with a lifestyle lift. Here's Eloise today at age 72, looking younger, refreshed, and natural. How did she do it? Call Lifestyle Lift to find out. It's that easy. Get your free information kit and imagine how you can start looking younger today.
Monday.
I've got bubbles, air is escaping from someplace.
A scuba accident takes one diver from the bottom of the lake.
I started really feeling like I'm in trouble.
To the brink of eternity.
It was a place that I knew I was welcome.
We kick off our week of prayer.
I remember actually having to specifically make the decision. Do I stay or do I come back?
Monday on the 700 Club.
Well, 3 years ago, Robert Shuler was our guest on this program. Let's take a look back at part of his interview.
I was installed as the senior pastor of the Crystal Cathedral in January of 06. Mm-hmm. I was the senior pastor there for 2.5 years, and I want to thank my father and everybody else who made that possible. But the long and short of it is I have 4 sisters, and they're all involved in the ministry, and they have husbands, and they're all involved. And I just didn't feel it was appropriate to divide the ministry the way they wanted it divided. Mm. And so the bottom line was I believed that it was time for me to leave.
Aren't there some problems associated with that? I mean, it's Crystal Cathedral itself, for that ministry, if there's not defined succession, at some point in time, you look out into the future and say, what's the future?
Yeah. Well, at this point, I was removed from that position to make any decisions about what's going to happen in the future of that ministry.
Well, he was being very polite. Welcome back. How do you resist?
I'm still very polite. What do
you
mean?
You're still very polite. I noticed you were being a little cautious with what you're saying. How do you resist now the temptation to say, I told you so?
It doesn't do any good. And life goes on. You know, I'm a firm believer that God puts things in people's lives for a purpose and for a reason, that as pastors, as ministers, we're not going to be here forever. Our ministries are not going to last forever. And
hallelujah.
God puts, yeah, exactly. And God puts certain people in our lives for a particular reason, and we have a particular course we take, and there's a beginning and there's an end. And just because there's an end to something doesn't mean it's over. It's just an opportunity for new beginnings.
Well, I hear the hope in your voice, but there has to have been some kind of grieving here. Here's something that, your dad put his life into, and your whole family put their lives into.
Yeah.
You know, I know you were raised in ministry, mm-hmm. and to see it all go, and go in such a public way, it has to hurt.
My grieving started in July of 08. Mm-hmm. So I've been grieving this whole thing for the past 3.5-4 years.
And you saw it coming.
And on July 8th, no, it was July 9th, 2008, I knew that it was over.
It was all over what the decisions they were making and the directions they were taking. And so I started grieving at that point. Mm-hmm. But so now the cathedral has been sold, and there's still a congregation there. There's a congregation of about 1,100 people that continue to meet there every uh-huh. Sunday, and it looks like they may be moving to another location, and they definitely will move to another location in the next 3 years. But it'll probably be sooner than later. Mm-hmm. There is the Hour of Power broadcast, which could continue. In fact, it is still on Lifetime and Discovery and Trinity Broadcasting Network, Dimension 3. So I don't know what the future is there, but they've started using some of my old material back from 2008. Yeah, and 2007.
That must be strange for you.
Yeah, it is. I'm watching. I go and I watch it, and I just go, "Oh, look at there! I'm in a robe again."
I used to know that guy.
Yeah, exactly. That's about right. Yeah.
Have you reconciled with your sisters? Is that?
Do you know what? I'm in the process of doing that. Yeah, but it's really fresh, and for them, it's very fresh and it's very raw right now. They were asked to leave only a few weeks ago, basically. So, like I said, it's very, very... I don't think the timing is right for me to really try to do something there.
Through all of this, how do you come to a point of forgiveness where you let it go?
You know, that's really what this show is all about today.
Yeah.
You know, it's forgiveness. The music's about forgiveness And so I'm really honored to be part of this show and to be able to talk about this, because forgiveness is such an important part. Now, Jesus, it's probably been quoted 100 times today and probably another 100 times, and that is that Jesus told us to forgive 70 times 7. And we need to do that just in one day. Just in one day. And then the next day, do it 70 times 70 again.
So that happens to you too, huh?
Yeah, because what happens, especially when somebody's really hurt you bad, you know, you've really been slammed, you just constantly, these thoughts come into your mind. It's like, if only, if this, why did this happen? Why did that happen? And you can just really, if you don't just tackle that every single time and just tell yourself, forget it. Don't go there. Don't be this way. Forgive. And so in the course of a day, you could literally 70 times 7, because those thoughts will come in. And if you don't put those away and say, hey, forget about it, it'll destroy you.
Why is it harder to forgive when you're right?
That's a good question. I think if you're... when you're right, you're the one who's been offended, typically, I guess this would be the answer to that. But it's always hard to forgive when you haven't done anything wrong and you've been a victim. That's really when you need to forgive the most.
What happens when you don't? When you want to hold,
that's the real question.
When you hold on to, regardless, I'm right, or I'm victim, or what you did is wrong, and I need justice, and until I have justice, I'm not going to be happy.
That's the key. Number one, you cannot create your happiness around trying to get justice, around trying to make circumstances or situations in your life a certain way. Because, believe it or not, we're not in control. I mean, it's really hard for people to get to come to that to grasp with the fact that we are not in control. You know, the first three steps in a 12-step program, anybody who's involved in recovery of any addictions, of any life, deals with these three. I can't, he can, let him.
Right.
Okay? And that's good theology. It's good. It's a good way to live. It's a good way to think. It's a good way to feel. I can't, he can, let him. And so we begin to accept that. We begin our day in thanksgiving for what God has given to us instead of living in bitterness and trying to constantly say, if only this had happened, if only I could do that. And we can start blaming ourselves, and we need to forgive ourselves. There's a lot going on.
That was one of the hardest things I ever had to do, is forgive myself. Because I knew. And then you're into a whole different thing there. Anyway, your book. Yeah. I've been in your book all this week.
Thank you.
When you're down to nothing, God is up to something. Yeah. In one of your chapters, you deal specifically with having to lean hard into theology to make sense of what was going on with you. You really had to acknowledge God, you're sovereign. Yes, you've given us free will, but you're sovereign, and I'm going to lean into you. I can't do this. Well, why is it so important to really just surrender, to say, I don't control, and I'm not in control of the situation, but you can, and I'm going to trust you?
Well, like I said, you can't. I can't. He can. Let him. Is like, for me, has been a foundation of my life.
Sounds like you've been saying that every day.
I do. Absolutely. I say that every single day. That's part of my prayer for a living.
Well,
I can't. You can. Let me be part of your plan, Lord. And that's really what living is.
That's a prayer my father taught me.
Is it really?
Yeah. Not my plan. God, I want to be part of your plan.
Precisely.
You know, my plans, my expectations for my future are going to be wrong, but yours are going to be right.
Exactly.
So not my plan, but let your plan. Can I be part of your plan? Can I come alongside you?
Yeah.
And it's a much better way to go. You've taken on some real challenges, not just one cable network. You've got two, which in this day and age, I go, you know, go Robert. Because that's hard. It's hard to build one now. How's it going?
Well, we're not building them. We bought ones that were already existed, and they're growing.
You still got to build them.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, they're growing. They're doing well, and the company is doing great. So I'm really excited about that and the challenges and the opportunities that come along with it. And it's again, the whole concept that if you follow God's will for your life, he's going to lead you into places you never in a million years would have anticipated. But that's what God's all about. God's in the business of taking people who have broken, who are down to nothing. And I was at that place where I was down to nothing. Mm-hmm. And out of nothing, he created something. You know, one of my favorite songs is from the movie Chitty Chitty Bang Bang. It's from The Ashes Come the Roses of Success. And I don't want to sing it for you, but it's a...
Oh, please do.
From the ashes come the roses. From the ashes come the roses. Come the ashes come the roses. That's success. Yeah, but so there you go. You can applaud me for that one, you know. But anyway, that's how God works. He takes the ashes and he takes when we're down to that nothingness, and from there he builds a life that comes to a point where they recognize the fact they wouldn't be where they are if it wasn't totally due to God's sovereignty and grace and recreation. And that's the kind of person God can really work with.
A lot of Americans right now are going through that. They're going through the loss of a job, loss of a home. And a lot of people are saying, where do we go now? And what do we do now? What would you tell them to do?
Do anything. Do anything. Wake up that day and do something. Take a walk. Pick up the phone. Go through your Rolodex. Or Rolodex don't exist anymore, do they? That's a thing from the past. You can scroll through your phone list and say, okay, who shall I talk to today? And just start calling people. Do anything. Literally, do anything. And then what will happen is something will spark. God will move. And you'll have a conversation that you never anticipated. Suddenly, somebody will hear something they never heard before. And God will start to move. Because it's the old concept where even God can't steer a parked car. which I don't believe. I think he can somehow.
He can move it anywhere he wants to.
But, you know, it's the idea. Even God can't steer a parked car. And so if we're parked, if we're just sitting there in our bedroom or our living room saying, Oh Lord, please do something for me. Oh Lord, please do something for me. And we sit there all day long saying, Oh Lord, please do something for me. And we're a parked car. And then we get to the end of the day and say, you know, if only God would do something for me, my life would start to change.
You're getting into a life transformation company.
Yes.
And you're going to do this for people.
Yes.
Tell us about that.
Yeah, it's a total life transformation company. It's a brand new company that I'm working with. I'm going to be coaching people through life transformation. You know, there's a lot of different areas of life. I think everyone has seen different pie charts of physical, financial, spiritual, family, recreation, those pie charts.
Mm-hmm. Balance.
You know, and a balanced life. But I've never seen a pie chart with, except for the one that I wrote, where you have a circle in the middle of the pie chart. Mm. And the circle in the middle of the pie chart is power. Because then the pie chart becomes a wheel. And wheels move, and wheels change, and wheels transform, and wheels go place. Pies get eaten. Okay?
And wheels move down the road.
So, the power is hope.
15 seconds.
The power is hope, and hope comes from faith, just a mustard seed of faith, and you can move mountains.
All right, Robert's latest book is When You Are Down to Nothing, God is Up to Something. It's available wherever books are sold. We leave you with these words come up from Luke, forgive, and you will be forgiven. God bless you.
When the market crashed, I was sitting with 36 properties and about $6 million in debt. It felt like the weight of the world on me. And every night I would go to bed crying. I think that, you know, God could bring a message from this mess if he wants to. And I'm going to surrender this to him, and I'm going to trust him, and I'm just going to see what he does. I do believe giving made all the difference. And I think that where we put our money is where we put our faith. The Bible says that when we give to the Lord, he sees that. If it's your time of need, that is actually the best time to give. It's the greatest opportunity for the greatest return. He taught me so much about his grace, his unmerited favor and undeserved blessing. God wants to bless us when we give to him. We can't outgive God.